Okay, we have a public hearing that needs to start. Hereby call this meeting to order on Tuesday, June 7th at 6:30. In accordance with the Massachusetts General Law, Chapter 71, Section 38N, the hearing is now open for members of the public to discuss the proposed FY 2017 school committee's recommended Brockton Public Schools budget. The role of the school committee is to listen to comments and concerns. Members of the school committee will not respond to any statements or questions during the course of the hearing. In consideration of all the speakers, I ask that each individual complete their remarks within 3 minutes. After hearing all of the visitors, we will then close the hearing. So, we have two people that have signed up. I would invite Felicia Chalmers, please. Good evening. Welcome, Ms. Chalmers. How are you?
I'm good.
Am I pronouncing your name correctly?
Yes, you are.
Okay, great.
I'm a parent here, and I'm a resident of the city of Brockton. I moved to Brockton because the school system was excellent for my three children that have special needs. I'm very concerned about these budget cuts because cutting the budget would take away programs that children like mine would need to get out here to function every day as citizens coming up and growing up in this city. I'm really disappointed in the fact that we want to take away money from a community that needs it. The children in this community need this money, because this money, extracurricular activities, sports, all sorts of programs that would help with their learning each and every day. These children aren't just, you know, these children are our future. They're someday going to be school committee members. They're going to be mayors, presidents, whatever. We need to take the money that, you know, this $10 million and invest it in their future. We don't need to take away things that are so important. Education is so important. It's so important. I come from Tennessee, where my parents didn't get to have the opportunities that all these children get now. My parents worked hard. They couldn't go to college. It wasn't available for them. They didn't get a good education. Education is what is going to help our children to grow and to become better citizens of this United States. In order for our children to be prosperous adults, we have to invest in their future. Why are we taking money from the children? Is there no other way that the city can make cuts somewhere else? Why education? You know, I've been pondering this over and over again. Don't our children count? I think they're important, don't you? You know, we should be fighting every day to show our children that they're important. We need to show them that we care. We need to invest in them. If not us, who? You know, I'm so upset about this whole thing, and there are other parents as well that are very upset about this. You know, we love this city. We want our children, you know, to grow and be a part of this city. We don't want anyone to take away anything that could stop them from being productive men, young men and women. And if you go to other neighborhoods, it's funny because Brockton has a lot of minorities. And when you go to other neighborhoods like Acton and things, they have all sorts of programs for their children. After school, their children have tons of programs to go to. These children here in Brockton need the same thing. They need things to do. They need things to occupy their mind. They need, you know, programs that are going to help them to grow, become intelligent young men and women. I was impressed with the young person from Brockton High that just recently got the scholarship to go to the Ivy League schools. I felt so proud, you know, because this kid came from Brockton. Brockton, the very city that, you know, someone wants to take $10 million from. Brockton High has, you know, had such a great reputation. I followed the Forbes, when I saw us in Forbes, I was bragging about it. I was so proud of you know, what our teachers here do and what our staff do. But lately, with the budget cuts, I've become very disappointed. And I'm trying to wrap my mind around this whole thing. You know, I thought educators cared about children. You know, I thought, you know, governments were supposed to care about our future.
Thank you very much. Again, this isn't supposed to be a back and forth, but I'll just say this. I mean, everything you said, no one disagrees with on this committee. We're dealing with the numbers that the state provides us with. We are fighting for more funding from the state. There's a new funding formula that came down from the state that, in our opinion, severely disadvantages the city of Brockton and mm-hmm. our students. So it's not that we have taken money away, it's that we are working with the funds that have come in and we are trying to get more of those funds, we can assure you. So we're everyone in this room, all of the administrators, all the teachers, all of the educators, the mayor, the city council, the school committee, we are all on board and feel the same way you do, and we are advocating every day, and we have a campaign going on that we are pushing and trying to influence Beacon Hill to basically fully fund Brockton, just like you mentioned, with regard to the different communities that have things. And you know, we are tirelessly attempting to get more funding. So, you know, that's really all I can offer at this point. But I can assure you that, you know, we are not taking money away. We are trying to work with the money that we have been provided with from both the city and the state. And to be honest with you, this year, the city has put up more money than they ever have because of that gap that the state has left us with. So the city is trying to do its part, but we're all petitioning the state to do that, to do their part. So we're all on the same page, I can assure you. And you know, we're going to fight every day, and we're going to try to bring in additional funds.
Is there anything the city could do to include other organizations, such as the churches?
They could certainly call the governor's office and express their disappointment and the need in Brockton for the additional funding that we deserve for our students. That all of the church organizations, all of the citizens of Brockton that care, can call the governor's office and attempt to get their message through, because that's what we've been doing. And the more people that call, the better off we'll all be.
Okay, is there something that I could take with me so that we can
provide you with some contact information.
Well, okay.
Mrs. Chalmers, you know, thank you for coming here this evening. You know, as Vice Chairman Minicello was saying, you know, we're certainly advocating for our children. And I do want to assure you, you know, the budget is very tight, because one of the things that we do provide is we provide excellent teachers. We want to make sure that we have the best teachers coming to Brockton because of all the things we are dealing with. And unfortunately, we're in a time of economic downturn when we rely heavily on state and federal funding. You know, there are grants that are drying up that we used for after-school programs. You know, I've been around long enough that I can remember the days when we had so much money in grants and funding that we didn't know what to do with it. It was wonderful. All kinds of programs for kids after school. So we truly are hanging by a thread. But the one thing I want you to take away with is we, again, provide excellent services to our special education students. 89% of our over 1,000 graduates this past Saturday are going to 4- and 2-year colleges. We have these kids, you know, get some of the best scholarships around because of their aptitude, their achievement in school. So I feel like we have an excellent school system. The one thing that I'd like you to leave us, we have your information, is the Brockton Kids Count campaign. I'm hoping you have heard this.
Yes.
So one of the things, and it came very suddenly at a time where we were advocating, we were trying to get word out to parents, and we're very pleased with the response. And it's not just about a budget anymore. It will absolutely be about empowering parents and community members. So I would love Brockton Interfaith and the churches to get involved. You're a huge part of, and I've had discussions with people, as one of our community providers, to get involved with us to make sure parents are getting out there to register to vote. This is a great year when you think about a presidential election.
Exactly.
And it isn't just, it isn't about the presidential election, it's about our own city. And making sure that all of us work together, our officials know how important it is to, you know, to fund education, and it's our job as school officials to go out there looking for additional funding, grants, development. So this is all in the works. I guarantee you we're working very hard to support our children, and they are a priority to us.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Second, I would like to invite Simone Antunes. Did anyone else want to speak tonight? Okay. Okay. Is Simone Antunes here? No? Okay, so that person's going to pass. Okay, how many more people would like to speak? Two? Okay. Could you come down and just fill out this information, please? And
so what would you like?
My question is, will people also have an opportunity at the next school committee meeting at 8 o'clock, or is this the main hearing for this issue?
It is, right. We start another meeting at 7 o'clock. We will break, though, and go to the awards until probably about 8 o'clock.
And then at that, will you have another hearing time?
Yes.
So this is the budget hearing by law that regular school committee also has to speak at the hearing.
Oh, I can speak at the next one?
You can speak at either. This is about the budget.
Hey, wonderful things to say.
Is it about the budget? You can speak about the budget.
I can wait.
It's up to you. It's up to you.
I'll wait.
Okay. Okay. All right. Well, so Simone Antunes did not want to speak, correct? Okay, you're good. All right. Seeing that, is there anyone else that would like to speak at this time? On the budget at the public hearing?
I'll do it now.
Okay. Sue, can you just fill out the hearing of visitors form that's up there?
Right here?
Yes, there's two names ahead of you. Okay, Sue, did you want to speak now?
Oh, I thought there was someone.
She opted not to speak. So, okay.
Oh, you said there were two people ahead of you.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Yeah.
Ahead of me.
Okay. No, just on the list. Sorry.
I get it. Okay.
On the list. Sorry.
About that.
No problem. Right. Okay. Welcome.
Thank you.
The floor.
So, good evening. Superintendent Smith and school committee members and Chairman Minchello, thank you for the second opportunity to address you tonight. I spoke at the last school committee meeting about the proposed elimination of all those certified school librarians in the district, but I didn't have time to express all that I wanted to say about this topic. In the digital age, the role of the librarian and the use of libraries have gone through great changes. No longer is a school library, or IRC as we call it, the place that teachers and students have to go to find information or complete research. They can go to a lab or look on their smartphones, and a world of information is right there. So it's understandable why many would question the need for libraries or librarians in schools today. But this movement of research from print to digital platforms is a development that the library field has taken seriously, and I'm one of the librarians who has taken that seriously. We talk about transliteracy, which is the ability to read, write, and interact across a range of platforms, tools, and media. Here's one example. Recently, I helped an engineering teacher develop a project to study sound waves by having students create ringtones for their phones. He had sound files he wanted them to use, but he needed to find a way to easily share them with his students. I found a method for sharing the sound files, and developed a lesson on how to download them and use the program Audacity to create MP3s that they could send to their phones and use for ringtones, and I actually made one myself. It was a fun project. We traversed many platforms, tools, and media on this project, and the students both learned from and enjoyed doing this work. And of course, digital literacy is a very important component of that, and it's the ability to use technologies to find, evaluate, create, and communicate information. That's one of our most important roles. It's to help prepare students for college-level research, and that requires all the digital literacy skills. Again, a few weeks ago, a class came in for a lesson on the databases. They had a substitute that day, and she was a college junior, and she confirmed for us that in college they are required to use books and databases. They can't just Google in college. It's not acceptable. And we provide lessons on how to use the various research databases. These are constantly being updated and improved, and that's a difficult thing for teachers to keep up with on top of everything else that they're doing. We just this year got a feature that allows students to save articles to Google Drive, and I've been teaching them how to actively read and annotate the text, and again, a tool that is the student from college said, I wish they had this when I was in high school, and I ended up giving her all my handouts. So this is stuff to really help prepare them for college. And you know, teachers could do this in the lab, but not every teacher will, and also not every teacher will have time to keep up with all of this, so it adds another thing to their plate that we can do. And again, print literacy is still important as well as digital literacy. There are a lot of studies coming out that are finding that people tend to comprehend and learn more complex ideas better from print rather than digital text, so you still want to have a print library collection. Our current collection at the high school has over 30,000 volumes and has an estimated value of $734,000 right now. And it does seem important to have a professional who understands collection development to oversee that valuable resource. We also help with professional development. A couple of years ago, I taught a graduate level hybrid course on digital research strategies. I had everyone from kindergarten teachers to ELL teachers to special education teachers, high school and middle school teachers in that course. And so, you know, I'm reaching a lot of people across the district. It's not just my students in my class. It's system-wide, and that's what librarians do. We work with everyone. So I just want to put this out as an idea instead of eliminating librarians entirely. If you think, rethink how librarians might be used. I know right now money is tight, but you know, if you keep one or two and think maybe how could we reuse librarians in a better way so we get more bang for our buck in the future. Cambridge Public Schools has a great model. They have ICTS department, which is an Information Communication Technology Services department, and they actually have the instructional technology specialists and librarians working together, and they have a whole lab devoted to professional development that they have running all the time. So, you know, I know we don't have the money right now, and that's like a dream, but the idea is that maybe, you know, maybe there's a way to think about how we can meld the idea of transliteracy, the print to the digital, with the librarians, working with the instructional technology people, because we can do both, and the content, it's the technology is good, but the content is important as well. And so that's all I wanted to say. Thank you.
Okay. Very much.
And not just to rethink, but hopefully to save one or two positions. I don't want to. Thank you.
Okay, we have just a little bit of time left. Did anyone else want to speak at this time?
I just have a question. I know this is.
We're not supposed to really be fielding questions at this point, but you, once we end this, please come down and talk to us. Okay, so. Is there anyone else that wanted to have a turn and make a statement? Okay. We now, seeing no further visitors who would like to speak, I now would entertain a motion from someone to close the public hearing with respect to the budget.
Motion to close public hearing with respect to the budget.
I need someone to second it. Any further discussion on that? Seeing none, all in favor? Okay. officially the public hearing on the budget is closed. Okay, we have a lot to do tonight, so I hereby call this meeting to order. Please join me in saluting the flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. We have an award ceremony. It's a very wonderful student recognition night. So the school committee is going to move to suspend the school committee meeting for approximately, give or take, an hour so that we can attend the award ceremony. And then we will reconvene here to complete the business of the school committee for the meeting of June 7th. So may I please have a motion from someone on the committee to suspend the meeting for approximately an hour in order to attend the Student Recognition Awards Night.
Motion to suspend the meeting for the Student Awards Night.
Okay, second. Any further discussion? Seeing none, all in favor? Okay, great, so we're gonna suspend the meeting. We'll be back in approximately 1 hour. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. If you could kindly take your seats, we will begin this evening's presentation. Thank you for attending. My name is Tom Minicello. I'm the vice chair of the school committee. Unfortunately, the mayor must attend the budget hearings at City Hall and cannot be with us tonight, but he informed me of his regrets. Please stand for the presentation of the colors. Please join us in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Please stand while the colors are posted. Oh. Please be seated. How wonderful is that? Our JROTC is just top notch. They win all sorts of awards throughout the state. We probably have the best program in Massachusetts and probably in all of New England. But it just goes to show you how proud we are of our young people. I'd just like to point out for this evening, you see there are many seats that there are students unable to attend this evening. And why that is that we have many competing events tonight. There's some band events going on. There's some drama events going on. And unfortunately, fortunately, it goes to show you how many students are involved in different things. But unfortunately, they're unable to attend this evening to accept in person their awards. So we will certainly make sure they get the awards. All family and friends, I'm sure you're very proud of these students and the accomplishments that these students have achieved. It just goes to show you that through hard work and support at home, how your student, your child, your baby has grown and continues to make you proud. We have so much to be grateful for in our Brockton Public Schools. I can't imagine any better school system. Our students are exposed to so much, and they are so fortunate to have such wonderful teachers and staff who dedicate themselves to learning and to commit themselves to the betterment of your child. But again, this wouldn't happen without your support. So we also naturally want to acknowledge family. And family, as you know, comes in many different shapes and forms today. But a positive, a nurturing, and a steady hand, consistency at home, and this is the result. You have these wonderful students who have achieved so much. I'd like to introduce the superintendent of schools, Kathleen Smith, who will join with the rest of the school committee in presenting these awards tonight. Thank you, and please enjoy the evening. You have a lot to be proud of.
Thank you, Mr. Minicello, and I want to welcome our school committee here, parents, friends, and certainly our award recipients. Congratulations. This is a wonderful event, and it's wonderful for all of us. It's certainly wonderful for the students that work so hard, whether it was in the classroom, on a project, the band, the drama, the athletes, our artists. All of you excel in so many ways. And every day, there's not a day that goes by that I am not proud of being the superintendent of the Brockton Public Schools, and that's because each and every one of you. I truly want to thank the parents out there. As Mr. Minicello said, this wouldn't happen without you. It is a partnership that is the most important partnership in your child's life. It truly sets them up for the goals that they will attain as they go forward. It is bittersweet when I look out and see our seniors that just graduated this past Saturday. You know, what a class, the class of 2016. It has been a wonderful 4 years. Let's give them a hand. Come on, let's give them a hand. They have set that bar very, very high with all of, again, their achievements over their years here in the Brockton Public School. So this will probably be their last award ceremony. We're thrilled that they could join us this evening. If all of you young students truly look up to that class, a class that had character, a class that had perseverance, and a class that, again, each and every day made us proud to say that, you know, we are members of the Brockton Public School family. And before we begin with the awards, I do want to thank our communications director, Michelle Bolton, who put together this event along with our fabulous administrative interns who are in their final weeks of their internship projects, along with the high school that certainly sets this up for us every year. So without going on any further, let me start by saying the first group of awards is going to be math and science, grades 6 through 8. They're going to be presented by Coordinator Joan Farrington, coordinator of our math and science 6 to 8. And would you please all hold your applause until the last student in each category has received their awards. And as always, please turn off your cell phones. Thank you.
Thank you, Superintendent Smith, Mr. Minicello, and members of the school committee. It's always a pleasure to be here tonight to recognize all the fine students that we have in Brockton for all of their fine achievements. I'm going to begin giving out awards tonight for the New England Math League. I am pleased to announce the results of the New England Math League contest. For the 34th consecutive year, students from Brockton have placed on the grade 6, 7, or 8 list at either first, second, or third place in the local community. As in the past, this year's competition included students from various public and private schools throughout Massachusetts and New England. Each school that participated in the contest submits their top five students and an individual team score. The contest consists of 35 math problems that must be completed in 30 minutes. These are not easy problems. The Math League considers 15 correct a good score. I extend my congratulations to all of these students and to their teachers for a job well done. So I will call up each team, and some of these students will be receiving two awards because they received an individual high score as well as a team score. We'll begin with the Pliff Academy, who won a second place team award. The first member of that team is Vinnie Hune, who won a second place individual award as well. So Vinnie, come on up. Next, we have Julia Drukas, Andrew Cameron, Alex Dos Santos, and Jacob Hayden. The next group of students I'll call up are the Grade 7 awards. Grade 7 had a first place team at North Middle School this year, something we haven't done in quite a few years. They will receive a plaque, which I think they already have received, to display in the office recognizing their achievement. So this is a North Middle School team with a total score of 112 points. They had also a first place individual winner, Joshua Vega. Wait, is Josh here? Next, we have Antonio Campos, Christopher Domerkant, Noah Alohu, and Samira Cobone. Our next group from Pluff Academy, we had a total score of 111 points. And remember, we're talking 15 points was considered a good score. We have five students together getting a score of 111 points. Nice job overall. So we have our leader of this team. Third place individual score goes to Kayla Costello with a point value of 23. Next, Nicholas Bartuccino, Alyssa Kalp, Julia Gill, and Grant Gitz. Now to the grade 8 team. Grade 8 team from Pluff Academy, total points of 91. I think we can see that the 8th grade test must have been kind of difficult. So we have from Pluff, again, a second place individual score, Rixon Zeng. Next we have Susan Takang, Jason Stevens, Charbel El-Halou, Alexander Guerrera Hippolyte, and Lisandro Velasquez. Our final group comes from the Ashfield School. They had a third place finish with a total score of 82 points. The first member of the team is Joseph Murphy, followed by Aiden Burke, Madison Texera, Taryn Bennett, Brandon Da Silva, and Elizabeth Williams. That concludes the math award, so let's have a round of applause for those students, please. The next awards I'll give out this evening are the Science Fair Awards. These students began their projects months ago and have participated in multiple science fairs throughout the school year. They competed locally at the City Science Fair in April. 25 projects from that fair moved on to the regional fair at Regis College in late April. Two Brockton students received honorable mention at that fair, and they competed this past weekend on Saturday at Worcester Technical High School at the State Science Fair. The two winners of the regional fair, Haley Ricks with an honorable mention, I don't think she's here tonight, for Soak It Up was the name of her project, and Samir Boshebi, honorable mention at the regional school fair for his project on the point of parabola, and also third place at the State Science Fair. Great job. Round of applause, please. Thank you. And now it's my privilege to introduce to you Dr. Ethan Cancel, who will present the awards for students who received perfect scores on the MCAS and PARC assessments.
I want to thank the superintendent and the school committee for honoring the academic achievements of our students. As you all know, MCAS is one of the most challenging exams in the country. We also now have PARC, which is a multi-state collaborative, and next year we're going to have MCAS 2.0. With all of these standardized tests, Massachusetts regularly leads the country in results. The students who we're going to recognize tonight did something truly amazing, and it's very worthy of our praise. As Mr. Minicello pointed out, the students could not have done this without the support of their families, their teachers, their classmates, and their schools. I want to add some context for you before I read off the names, just so you can understand the incredible accomplishments that we're talking about tonight. There are about 70,000 10th grade students who took the MCAS in ELA. 254 of those students earned a perfect score. That's basically a third of a percent. And we've got one of those students right there. For math in grade 10, slightly more took the test, and about 1,000 scored a perfect score. That might sound like a lot, but that's actually 1.5%. That's it in the entire state. When we shift over to PARC, those were MCAS scores for 10th grade. For PARC, we had two students in grade 3 achieve perfect scores. It turns out that less than 0.5% scored perfect in PARC in third grade. It also turns out that we had one student who, as a third grader, had a perfect PARC score on the online version of PARC. That's less than 0.2% of the students who took the test scored a perfect score online. That's just an incredible accomplishment. So that's the context. Now, without further ado, for the moment you've been waiting for, this is the third time I've had the privilege to announce for 10th grade ELA perfect score, Jennifer Greiner. And the other students were unable to attend, but we have, in 10th grade for math, we had Jasmine Andrade, we had Michaela Donovan, and the third grade perfect scores, both for ELA, were Elizabeth Bernadin and Grace Vega. It is now my privilege to introduce Dr. Julian Andrade, who will present the awards for the Little Red Schoolhouse Association Citywide Spelling Bee.
Thank you, Dr. Cancel. Good evening, everyone. Each spring, students in grades 3 to 8 in all the Brockton public schools, private and parochial schools, square off at the Little Red Schoolhouse Association's annual spelling bee. Each contestant has won a grade-wide spelling bee to represent their school, and the winners of the City Bee are awarded prizes from local sponsors. We are pleased with the excellent performance of our young spellers this year. I am happy to announce the first place winners of each grade spelling competition. Grade 3, first place, Jocelyn Protentis, Hancock School. Grade 4, first place, Enabong Anako, George School. Grade 5, first place, Jane Liu, Angelo School. Congratulations to these winners. And now it's my privilege to introduce Eileen McQuaid, Middle School ELA Coordinator, who will present the awards for the Little Red Schoolhouse Spelling Bee and National History Day Awards for middle school.
Thank you, Dr. Andrade. We have first place winners for the citywide spelling bee with us here tonight, and it was a beautiful day, beautiful Saturday, and it was a tough competition, and we'd like to thank the moderators and the judges, and especially Susan O'Connell, who worked so hard with the Little Red Schoolhouse Association to make sure that it's a success. And here we have our winners for 6 to 8. For grade 6, Isabella McNutt from Pluff Academy. Our grade 7 winner, and this was a tough contest, is from the Davis School, James Corden. And our grade 8 winner from the Pluff Academy is Frederick Odom. It is also my pleasure, oh, go ahead, clap for it. Frederick did a great job, all the Spelling Bee winners. It is also my pleasure to present to you the distinguished junior winners of the Regional National History Day competition for 2016. We are so proud of the Brockton Middle School students who represented their city so well. They worked so hard. They researched for hours and hours. Their teachers gave so many hours to these projects, and they really presented well at the competition. Please join me in recognizing these wonderful young history scholars. So for the junior group exhibit, we have the title of their exhibit was Devil's Music, Jazz, and Race in America, and they're all from the Pluff Academy. And they got second place for the junior group exhibit. We have Leslie Cabrera Luna, Ketavan Dezazde, Samantha Gideon, Lisandro Velazquez, Zetalina Aleon Marat. That's second place winners. And for the junior, go ahead. And for the junior individual website, we have honorable mention for the project called The Exchange, Nazi Secrets to America, from West Middle School, and the teacher is Rich Little. They got honorable mention, John Purnell III. In the junior individual documentary division, we also had an honorable mention winner for the project entitled Islamic Women Encountering Sexism from West Middle School, and the teacher was Rich Little, Laura Gayot. For the junior group documentary division, we had for the project entitled The Great Depression in Massachusetts, from West Middle School, the teacher was Matt Campbell. This group placed honorable mention, Daniel Hernandez and Rajan Battle Jr. Mm-hmm. We have some junior individual performance winners. For her performance, Mary Chilton, Life as a Pilgrim from West Middle School, teacher Matt Campbell, this student placed second place, Annalise Rivera. For third place in the junior individual performance category for her project called The Norman Conquest, from West Middle School, Marva LeConte. Marva's teacher was also Matt Campbell. And with an honorable mention, we have Ariana Drukron for her project called History of Video Games from West Middle School, and her teacher was Rich Little as well. And then, and then finally, junior group performance category for first place. Yay. Mark Balson and Ryan Trin for their project called The Founding Fathers from West Middle School, and their teacher was also Matt Campbell. First place winners in the regional. We're very, very proud. And then our winners went on to compete at the state competition, and we, for a junior individual performance, we got honorable mention to Marva LeConte from West Middle School. Thank you to everybody who competed in National History Day. We're all so proud of you. And now it's my privilege to introduce Brockton High School's Social Science Department Head, Dr. Emily Flores, who will present the awards for National History Day contest at the high school level.
Good evening, everyone. Each year, thousands of students across the country take part in the National History Day competition, which challenges students to become experts in a historical topic of their choice. Students in grades 7 through 12 competed in the paper, performance, documentary, website, and exhibit categories, sharing their knowledge and analysis of historical events before a panel of educators who judged their presentation, their knowledge, and their research abilities. It is my great pleasure to introduce you to these four ladies who were winners at the school level and then moved on to the regional competitions. In second place, with the project titled Exploring the Life of Hedy Lamarr, Miss Kasia Chalmers. And Kasia presented an individual website. Kasia presented individual exhibit. In first place for individual websites, with Polio, the Disease That Paralyzed America, Miss Isabel Charlotte. I don't know if you can see it from where their smiles are so big, they're so proud of themselves. And their parents are smiling harder back there. Group websites, second place. Americans Exploring Culture, the Harlem Renaissance, Ayella Watson and Jato Freeman. Now please welcome Foreign Language Department Head, Ms. Jane Rizzitano, who will present the National Latin Awards.
Good evening. So this is always a pleasure for me to be able to announce our Latin, National Latin Exam winners. So Latin students at North, South, and West Middle School, as well as Brockton High School, each year participate in the National Latin Exam. And there are over 148,000 students worldwide that participate in this particular exam. This year, Brockton students participated in several levels. And what I'm going to do is read their names by school and then give their teacher. I'd also like to take the opportunity to thank the students for their participation in the exam, but also to really thank their teachers for all the hard work and preparation that have enabled our students to succeed on this academic exam. And the Foreign Language Department is very proud of each of you. So, from Mr. Sullivan in Latin 1 at Brockton High School, we have Gold Summa Cum Laude, Maya Charles, and Talia Bruno, and Sheila Gomes. Silver Maxima Cum Laude, Tavius Bruno, and several Magna Cum Laudes, Jada Osias, Valdo Andrade Laureo, Dale Quimby, Evia Vicente, Molly Sullivan, and then a cum laude from Jade Zubras. For Latin 2, cum laude, Mrs. Cook student, Diamond Ogbena. And for Latin 3, also Mrs. Cook student, a silver maxima cum laude, Deborah Coban. For North Middle School, these are also Mr. Sullivan's students. Latin 1, Gold Summa Cum Laude, Stacy Paulino Mendonca. Silver Maxima Cum Laude, Delnicia Livramento. And Brianne Joseph. Cum laude was Isaiah McConaughey. Now, the students from South Middle School have a concert tonight and are unable to attend, but these are Ms. DeMora's students, and I'd just like to read their names, if I may. So, for Latin 1, Silver Maxima Cum Laude, Arnikesha Cherry and Brianna Sterling. Magna Cum Laude, Judzel Lewis, Anaya Jordan, Devin Robinson. It looks like we have some of them here. Yay! Elizabeth Eaton and Jonathan Belizaire. Cum laude was Nathan Vega, Annie Lubin, and Sapphire Cromwell. Congratulations. And now from West Middle School, and these are all Mrs. Martell students, two gold summa cum laudes, Mark Valson and Heather Porto. Two silver maxima cum laudes, Tina Torres and Kyle Antoine. And two magna cum laude students, Saya Alvarado and Tiffany Hernandez. And also two cum laude students, Faith Lemieux and Marcelo Tenorio. Congratulations. Now, it's my pleasure to introduce Mr. Vincent Macrina, who will present the All-State Musical Festival Awards.
Good evening. Brockton High School and our entire school system is known to the state and the country for its high quality of its musician, both instrumentally and in choral member. It gives me great pleasure to introduce to you outstanding young musicians being honored tonight for their achievements and representing Brockton High School and the city at the all-state level. The following students were accepted to perform with the 2016 Massachusetts All-State Chorus. Macaulay Burse. A few people up. Also, not present this evening, these students were also accepted to the All-State Chorus: Nathaniel Smith, Brian Vasquez, Khalib Sansurin, and Joseph Polveri. You can clap for that, yes, sir. The following students were chosen to perform for the 2016 American Choral Directors Association Eastern Division Honor. That's over 11 states. Representing us there is Alexis Katsiopoulos. Michelle Garcia. And also two students that are not here, Nathaniel Smith again, and Brian Vasquez. And finally, representing us at the 2016 Massachusetts All-State Jazz Ensemble, one of the very few students to make it on this year, is Ryan Shaw. Thank you. And now it gives me pleasure to introduce you to the art director, Sarah Richards, who will present the All-State Scholastic Award.
Good evening. The Brockton Public Schools Fine Arts Department is pleased to announce that 9 students from the high school and 3 students from 2 middle schools have won 15 honors in the 2016 Scholastic Art and Writing Competition. These awards recognize the hard work, dedication, and talent of the students and the teachers of the Brockton Public Schools Art Department. Our students continue to represent the city well, and they inspire others with their creativity. From North Middle School, Douglas Chavez, Gold Key Mixed Media, and Giovante Gilmate, Gold Key Mixed Media. From East Middle School, Sean Pyres, Silver Key Drawing. From Brockton High School, Jamar Vassell, Gold Key and Honorable Mention in Painting, as well as a National Gold Medal Painting. Pedro Gomes de Luz, Silver Key Painting. Jailton Textera, Honorable Mention, Painting. Samantha Doherty, Honorable Mention, Drawing. Olivia Ha, Honorable Mention, Drawing. Marcio Varela, Honorable Mention, Painting and a Silver Key Sculpture. Richard Fernandez Fonts, Honorable Mention, Sculpture. Jamie Ocasso, Gold Key Sculpture and a National Silver Medal Sculpture. Elisa Lewis, Honorable Mention, Sculpture. And they are not here, but we're very proud of them all. Next, we have the Congressional Art Competition. This is the first year we entered in this competition, and Congressman Stephen F. Lynch recently announced that Jailton Texera of Brockton won this year's Congressional Art Competition, an artistic discovery, in the 8th Congressional District of Massachusetts. The annual art competition is open to all high school students across the country. The winning pieces of artwork from each congressional district is selected to hang in the United States Capitol in Washington, D.C. for 1 year. The judges selected a charcoal drawing entitled Future by Jailton Texera, a junior at Brockton High School. The judges noted that Jailton's drawing had wonderful craftsmanship with great attention and detail and provided a strong and complete narrative. Jailton's artwork has been flown to Washington, D.C., where it will be displayed in the U.S. Capitol, and we're very proud of Jailton. And I have a few drama club awards. They also have another event tonight. But the New England Drama Festival, this year 124 high schools competed in the preliminary level of the New England Drama Festival. The Brockton High School Drama Festival production of Scapino was one of only 14 selected to compete at the state finals. The cast and crew won accolades at all 3 levels of competition. This group of students worked hard to put the show together, and they made us all very, very proud. There are an additional 3 students that won individual awards that I'd like to recognize tonight. Keenan Thomas won the Doug Ingalls Scholarship for Acting. Anna Coots received an honorable mention for set design. Anthony Picanzi and Taylor Tai won first place for the METG video contest. And now may I present Lieutenant Colonel Richard Clark to present the JORTC awards.
Good evening. We'd like to recognize our top four cadets who have been recently selected as the cadet leaders for the Junior ROTC program for the remainder of this year and next. Junior ROTC is a character and leadership development program. It differs from most other programs in the sense that cadet involvement is critical to its success. As such, our cadets are continually presented with leadership challenges and opportunities in which they can develop their interpersonal, problem-solving, decision-making, and communicative skills while simultaneously learning something about their own character. As the key leaders, these four will be given the enormous opportunity of leading and managing the program's administrative, operational, and logistical actions necessary to support school and community events. Their ranks, names, and positions are as follows. Cadet Lieutenant Colonel Jesus Alvarez, Battalion Commander. Cadet Major Kelvin Vino, Battalion Executive Officer. Cadet Major Bella Aguilar, Battalion Operations Officer. And Cadet Command Sergeant Major Shane Phillip, the Battalion Command Sergeant Major. It's now my pleasure to introduce our Athletic Director, Peter Caruso, who will present the All Scholastic Athletic Awards.
Good evening. It is my honor to present to you the outstanding athletes of Brockton High School, young men and women who have demonstrated skill on the playing field, but also scholastic aptitude in the classrooms. These young athletes have made us proud to be called the City of Champions. We had 36 all-scholastic nominations this year and 81 league all-stars without the spring season. I'll present them to you by season and their sport. From the fall season, football, Marcus Bullard, Enterprise All-Scholastic, and Super 26. Ben Cowett, Enterprise All-Scholastic. Gene Gellin, Enterprise All-Scholastic. Kingsley Ijogo Dike, Enterprise All-Scholastic. Ryan Clifford, Enterprise All-Scholastic. Men's soccer. Rich Robbins, he was voted the Boston Globe Division I Coach of the Year. Maldini da Fonseca, Enterprise All-Scholastic and Boston Globe All-Scholastic. John Santos, Enterprise All-Scholastic, Herald All-Scholastic, and Boston Globe All-Scholastic. Girls soccer, Gabriella Del Pico, Enterprise All-Scholastic. Maria Del Pico, Enterprise All-Scholastic. From men's cross country, Christopher McCaffrey, Enterprise All-Scholastic. And Matthew Kerrigan, Enterprise All-Scholastic. From golf, Deron Merrion, Enterprise All-Scholastic. And Mike Moran, Enterprise All-Scholastic. Girls cross country, Patricia Malinge, Enterprise All-Scholastic. And Sancha Alexis, Enterprise All-Scholastic. Girls volleyball, Tony Fairhurst, Enterprise All-Scholastic. Samantha Landry, Enterprise All-Scholastic. Courtney Francis, Enterprise All-Scholastic. And Narayan Paris, Enterprise All-Scholastic. messed you up. Now to the winter season, men's basketball. Jonathan DeVivier, Enterprise All-Scholastic and Boston Herald All-Scholastic. He will also be receiving a special certificate for scoring 1,000 points in his career here at Brockton High School. Brian Henry, Enterprise All-Scholastic, and Marquise Goncalves, Enterprise All-Scholastic. Girls basketball, Jelani Jackson, Enterprise All-Scholastic. Ice hockey, Corey Paul, Enterprise All-Scholastic. Ian Peterson, Enterprise All-Scholastic. Men's indoor track, he's here again. Chris McCaffrey, Enterprise All-Scholastic. Eddie Fong, Enterprise All-Scholastic, Boston Globe All-Scholastic, The Herald All-Scholastic, and he was the qualifier for the Eastern Regionals. Rudiano Ramos, Enterprise All-Scholastic. The girls indoor track, Sarah Remy, Enterprise All-Scholastic. Rihanna Allen, Enterprise All-Scholastic. Wrestling. He is not here, but Cole Wyman was the Enterprise All-Scholastic, Boston Globe All-Scholastic, and Boston Herald All-Scholastic, as well as the state and Eastern Mass champion. Devin Wynn, Enterprise All-Scholastic. Olivia Lopes, Enterprise All-Scholastic. And last but not least, from swimming, Sarah Leonard, Enterprise All-Scholastic. I don't know. And from field hockey, this is my fault because I can't see in the dark here. Maddie Marchand, Enterprise All-Scholastic. I can't see. All right. I believe that's it. That's it. We're all set.
Can we have Jonathan?
Jonathan DeVivier, please come up.
Back up here.
Superintendent Smith will present to Jonathan DeVivier a memento of a basketball signifying his 1,000 points here at Brockton High School.
Wow, that was something, wasn't it? It's just amazing to see all the different talented students we have in so many different areas. I was telling some of the students that were coming up for the spelling bee, I was asking them, who is more nervous, you or your parents? And most of the time it was the parents. So, and the one good thing was that Superintendent Smith was the moderator of the first eighth grade spelling bee, and the mayor and myself were the judges, and we made no mistakes. You don't know how nervous the judges are to make sure in these spelling bees that everything goes smooth because so much is at stake for these students. I would just like to close and basically say to all of the parents, you have done a wonderful job. I'm sure that you can't believe how big and how old your students are getting, your children are getting. So just enjoy them when they're small, enjoy them when they're big. And thank you all for doing so much. And I would like to also thank again the staff and the teachers and all of those people who have been a positive influence in these students' lives, because without you, without that steady hand, that consistency, this does not happen. So thank you all. And I'd like to just give you all a round of applause.
Please enjoy the evening. The school committee will now reconvene in the little theater for the rest of the evening for the school committee meeting. Thank you all again. Bye-bye. Pause. We will start off with our hearing of visitors. The hearing of visitors is an opportunity for people to present to the school committee issues of concern. You have 3 minutes to present your presentation, and the school committee listens, takes it under advisement, and does not interact, question, or comment. So we have three people that have signed up. Could I please invite up Allison Colarusso, please? Good evening, Allison. How are you?
Good. How are you?
Good. Welcome.
Thank you. Superintendent Smith and members of the school committee, I want to thank you for allowing me to speak to you tonight. I sit before you, a Brockton Public Schools teacher who received my second pink slip on May 13th. May 13th was a very difficult day for all of the schools in Brockton because we all knew that every pink slip that went out meant less and less for the district next year. I want to share with you a few stories that show exactly why each and every classroom position is imperative to the district. Last year, I was a first-year teacher at the Raymond School and taught fourth grade. My year started out great. I had wonderful students that were growing together as a class, and I could not be more proud. The Raymond School, like many other elementary schools in the district, does Student of the Month for every classroom based on a specific character trait. In my classroom, I had the students vote for who they thought best exhibited the trait. On Friday, January 30th, 2015, my class sat in the assembly that honored their chosen January Student of the Month. Their choice for the month was Marley Soares. Exactly a week later, February 6th, 2015, I went to school expecting it to be like any other day, but I soon found out that I was very wrong. That day I was told that Marley Soares was killed by her own mother the night before. My role as their teacher quickly changed. I knew that this news was going to be dramatically affecting my class because Marley was the student that everyone got along with, the student who was always helpful to others. As I processed in my head how I was going to tell my class of fourth graders that their friend had died, I quickly realized that being a teacher goes so far beyond the content you teach them in the classroom. I was not only their teacher, I was their shoulder to cry on, their person to talk to, their second parent, their friend, their consistency, and the list goes on. A teacher's job goes beyond teaching students about fractions or how to decode a text. As the rest of the year went on, my students slowly worked through losing a classmate. Towards the end of the year, many of my students asked me, "Next year, if I get sad, can I come to your classroom and talk to you for a little bit?" I honestly did not have the heart to tell them that I had been pink-slipped and was unsure of where I would be in the fall. Unfortunately, I was not called back by the end of the year, so I lost my spot at the Raymond, and every day I think about how I'm not there for my class last year after everything we went through. However, I was called back on August 24th to teach third grade SEI at the Davis School. SEI was going to be a whole new world for me. I knew that all of my students would still be learning English as their second language, and that I would even have some students that spoke no English at all. I did realize that this would be a very important year for many of them. This could be their first year of school in America. I can say that this year has been incredibly rewarding as I have watched students who came to America in September now speak and even read in English. However, like all SEI or ESL teachers, I was not only responsible for teaching them the curriculum, but how to adjust to life in America. This included how to interact with adults and students, how to behave in a classroom, how to take school seriously, and so on. Each student needs and deserves that attention. What will happen next year if those 59 positions are in fact eliminated? Many of the students could fall through the cracks because teachers would have 35 plus kids in a class. For the past few months, I have sat at the finance meetings and the school committee meetings, and I worry about the effects that the budget will have on our students. Our class sizes are already large, and teachers are being pulled in. However, we all go in and day out and pay for our own supplies, pay for students who cannot afford to go on field trips, create our own resources, and are constantly trying to make do with the little that we have. My fear is that after a while, amazing Brockton teachers will leave the district because they are tired of class size increasing with no additional support. Also, as a lifetime resident of Brockton, I fear for our city. Teachers are more than just a number on a seniority list. We are more than just a salary to be cut to meet a budget. We are building the future of Brockton in our classrooms every single day. Thank you.
Okay. Could I please invite down Susan Guidobani?
Hi, good evening. Thank you for inviting me to speak this afternoon, this evening. I'm a second grade teacher at the Brookfield School, SEI teacher. This is my eighth year teaching in the district. I hold my elementary ed license, my ESL license, and I also have the SEI endorsement. In addition, I am Portuguese speaking. I received a blue slip because one of the second grade SEI positions is being eliminated next year, even though the population of Cape Verdean Creole students is constantly increasing. This is concerning to me. Our department was, cited this year by the coordinated program review because so many of our SEI teachers are not licensed in ESL. The district is doing a disservice to the SEI population by cutting and eliminating qualified teachers and putting the department in jeopardy, leaving non-ESL licensed teachers in the positions. There needs to be a better way to determine blue slips. Rather than seniority alone, there are many other important factors to consider, including licensure and compliance. I am dedicated to my students and their families and qualified for the position. I hope that more thought and consideration will be taken in the distribution of involuntary transfers. Thank you for your time and your listening.
Could I please invite up Juliet Coughlin?
Good evening, Superintendent Smith, Mr. Minicello, members of the school committee, members of the audience, and viewers of this broadcast. Yesterday, I attended my very first book club meeting. The book club meeting was special. In attendance were about 15 young people and 10 professionals with excellent educations, careers, and credentials. This group of about 25 individuals met to discuss the book The Soloist by Steve Lopez. During the conversation, I observed thoughtful discussion, high-level thinking, and a deep analysis of the text by everyone at the table, teachers and students. Thoughts and ideas were being exchanged and developed in a lively dialogue that lasted almost an hour and would have gone on longer had the evening school not needed to use the library space as a testing space. The young people were students of BHS who took time on a beautiful sunny afternoon to meet and discuss literature with faculty members who donated their time to do the same. This joint book club meeting was made possible by the certified teacher librarian who year after year has cultivated an active and thriving student book club. I come here tonight to request that the school department preserve the few libraries that still function in the system and staff each library with a licensed teacher librarian. Libraries are a great equalizer. Whether a person is rich or poor, he or she is welcome at the library. We learn in history class that books were precious items in earlier societies. Only the wealthy had access to books. The reason for this was not only because they were expensive to produce, but also the knowledge contained within them had the power to transform minds. Lack of libraries and certified librarians breeds apathy and ignorance. Ray Bradbury wrote in Fahrenheit 451, "You don't have to burn books to destroy a culture. Just get people to stop reading them." As a teacher in the system, a Brockton native, and a successful product of the Brockton Public Schools, I ask that you save our neediest students access to the knowledge that they so desperately need. Knowledge is power, and as a city, we need to empower our young people. Please consider the choice to rid the system of all licensed librarians and instead preserve the library program. This will enhance the direct classroom instruction and the lives of our students. Thank you.
Okay, the next portion of our meeting is the consent agenda. The consent agenda consists of a matter of routine, a number of items of routine business, whereby the items are blocked together and the school committee can vote either as a block or remove an individual item for further discussion. So at this point, let me ask the committee if there's anyone that would like to remove a particular item from the consent agenda. No? Okay. All right. Can I entertain a motion from someone to approve the consent agenda? Okay. A second from Ms. LaPlante. Okay. Any further discussion on it? Seeing none, all in favor? Okay. Wonderful. Okay. Next item is report of superintendent of schools. Are there any items you'd like to take out of order?
Yes, I would.
Okay. Wonderful.
So you're reading my mind. This evening, as always this time of year, this is very special. You know, an award of the Baron Sully Award. And having been director of community schools, this was probably the most exciting time of the year to truly honor those people that support so many things that happen in our Brockton community. Many times giving of their own hours, their own energies, and this is a wonderful way to give back that has really been going on for years in the Brockton Public Schools and the Brockton community. So this evening I'd like to invite down Maxine Richardson, our present director of community schools, for another couple of weeks. Maxine will be retiring at the end of June. Will be sorely missed by our district, and she will tell us a little bit about the recipient this evening and about that award.
Welcome. And I would also like to call Tom Kenny to sit with me here.
Mr. Kenny? Always pleased to have you back.
Great to be back. Thank you, Max.
And I just want to give you a little bit of a background about the Baron Sully Award. And it is given in memory of Albert N. Baron Sully. He's the former school committee member and also chairperson of the Community Schools Advisory Board. And he held that position for 6 years. He was dedicated and committed to the mission of community schools. And through his efforts, he set a standard for volunteerism that is long remembered by all of us. In appreciation for his efforts and in his honor, this award was established. The award has been presented each year since 1981 by community schools to honor an outstanding individual or group whose volunteer efforts have had an impact on the lives of Brockton students and community members. I'm happy to report that Robert Bobby Bonnet, with a unanimous vote of the Executive Committee of the Community Schools Advisory Board, is the award recipient this year. He founded Save Our Sports and has worked tirelessly to promote quality athletics for Brockton students. I'm going to read a letter that Tom wrote to me on behalf of the group, and this is what Tom wrote. Dear Maxine, I would once again like to nominate my good friend and Brockton's good friend, Bobby Bonnet, for the Albert N. Baron Sully Award. Bobby, BHS class of 1950, founded the Save Our Sports organization 25 years ago this summer, along with Tom Pileski and Jim Kobus. The group has raised hundreds of thousands of dollars for the children of Brockton, and Bobby has been there every step of the way, from running carnivals to 50-50 raffles and everything in between. His bus trips to Foxwoods are an annual event that many look forward to. He is still an active member of the Brockton community and a fixture at all sporting events. Bobby is a member of our BHS Athletic Hall of Fame. Please consider this wonderful man for the Baron Sully Award. It would mean the world to him. And Bobby just celebrated his 84th birthday. Sincerely, Tom Kenny.
Okay, thank you, Maxine. 25 years ago, Brockton was in a financial crisis. The school system was forced to initiate user fees for all extracurricular activities and athletics. Tom Pileski, our athletic director at that time, reached out to the community. And he, along with Jim Kobus and tonight's recipient, Bobby Bonnet, founded the aptly named Save Our Sports organization. At this time, I would like to ask Tom Pileski to come down to talk about our friend and tonight's award winner, Bobby Burnett. Ladies and gentlemen, Tommy Pileski.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Tom, for those kind words. For those of you who know Bobby Burnett, he has a familiar saying, Burnett, two N's, two E's, and two T's, often imitated, never duplicated. Bob is one of a kind. Enter to learn, leave to serve. Bob epitomizes this motto. When he entered Brockton High School in the late 1940s, he learned quickly and realized that he did not have the size to play football, nor the skills to play baseball. Therefore, Bobby volunteered to be the team manager in both sports. He also served as a gopher for then the athletic director and football coach Frank Saber. I'm not really sure whether Bob volunteered or whether Bob tried to get out of his physical education classes in order, okay, to do errands for Coach Saber. Upon graduation, Bobby enlisted in the Air Force and served his country with distinction. For the next three decades, Bobby could be seen at various BHS athletic events. Fast forward to 1991. Just as Al Varoncelli was a driving force behind the creation of the Brockton Community Schools, Bob Burnett, with the support of his wife Sherry, along with a number of other volunteers, founded the Brockton High School Sports Foundation, commonly known as Save Our Sports. The group was funded because of severe budget cuts and their impact on sports programs. Bob Burnett, first and foremost, headed the Memorial Day weekend carnival for many years, along with his committee, not raising thousands, but tens of thousands of dollars for our student athletes here in Brockton. He was also an integral part of selling of banners and advertising space at Marciano Stadium, and has been involved in our pasta nights, night at the races, penny drives, and heads up excursions to Foxwoods. Bob was often heard on then WBET advocating for Save Our Sports and our student athletes. To this day, Bob can be seen at BHS basketball games running the 50-50 raffle. In addition, he sponsored the Brockton Tigers of the prestigious Cranberry League. The Pittsburgh Pirates Hall of Fame pitcher, Roberto Clemente, who was tragically killed while on a volunteer mission to the Dominican Republic, said it best, "Volunteerism is something you do for others and not expect anything in return." Bob Burnett and his wife Sherry did not have any children attend the Brockton Public Schools. All Bobby wants to do is serve the student athletes of Brockton High School. May I present to you two N's, two T's, two E's, Bobby Burnett.
You can speak. Bobby would like to take a picture first.
Very nervous.
Yep. Tom's want to come down? We'd like to take a picture. Bobby, can you come up here with us? We'd like to get an official picture.
Congratulations. Good job.
Thank you. Congratulations. It's so good to see you.
Hey, why don't you stand right with the superintendent? Hey, Tom.
Oh, good.
Thank
you.
This is a plaque that will be in community schools with Bobby's name added to it.
honor Bobby at the Rocks game Friday, June 17th. I'm trying to talk him into throwing out the first pitch. tonight we're calling Once a Boxer, Always a Boxer. We're inviting the whole community to come to the ball game, and at that night we'll have Bobby out on the mound. So it should be a great night, Bobby.
I'll take the tickets.
Now say something, join us, and please say a few words.
Thank you.
I do have to tell you, back in 1991, I was there for those very tough years
and had little kids at the time. And I'll never forget hearing about Save Our Sports for the first time. And Mr. Pileski, am I wrong? There was a carnival. Correct, on the grounds of Brockton High, and many events, and it was the community coming together to, again, make sure that our kids had everything that they needed to be part of any of the extracurricular activities, including our sports. So, Bobby, you know, thank you from the bottom of my heart for all you have done for so many years for so many people, and we're thrilled that you are getting the Baron Selye Award this year.
Thank you. I'd like to thank Tom Kenny for submitting my name into the barrel, and I also like to thank Mr. Pileski for saying the kind words about me, and also like to thank the Brockton Community Schools for nominating me for the Baron Selye Award. I really appreciate it, and I accept it with great honor, and I will cherish this.
There are people who work very quietly, do not look for any adoration, and perform Herculean efforts. And that's what Save Our Sports has done for the Brockton school system. We've recently looked to Save Our Sports to help us with respect to intramural programs, and they stepped up. It's not something that they ever really did, but for the budget a couple of years ago, it was really bad, and they generously gave of themselves. And Mr. Bonet is just one of those people who, you know, works quietly behind the scenes, but he might not be that tall, but he's pretty huge in stature in terms of what he does and what he accomplishes. So again, thank you so much. You just the way you conduct yourself shows the character that you truly are. I hate to go on to another item, but I guess we have to.
It's quite a night. I do want to say, as I do the report of the superintendent of schools, you just heard me mention, you know, being around in 1991 when times were tough. I was around in 1981 when times were tough. And I sit here today. So a couple of things. To Allison, Susan, and Juliet, the one thing that I want you to truly know is each and every teacher in the Brockton Public Schools is important to us. And we will do everything we can. One of our goals is to try to balance and stabilize this budget so we can provide an education, and we can make sure that when Allison is that first year teacher, and she is correct, doing more than just correcting papers, presenting lessons, you know, testing our students. You know, she provides much more support for them, and it is an investment that we make in our teachers, which is why our teachers do not want to leave us, and we do not want them to go. So please let us get through this very difficult work. Susan, again, you know, we are working with contract language, we're working with compliance, and there's a lot that goes into this, and believe me, we're working every day to make sure that we're looking at funding. We'll be talking next week about, as money come in, priorities. And one of the things I said last night in presenting to the City Council, that that in fact a priority for us is going to look at our classroom sizes and teachers in those classrooms as we look to secure more funding. We're truly doing everything we can, and we will not stop until we have our teachers back. And to Juliet, I thank you for supporting your colleague and for supporting each other, because that is what we have here. We are a Brockton Public School family, and again, please understand that as I said, we're working as hard as we can to try to stabilize the district and make decisions in the best interest of our kids and our community. So I assure all of you that obviously it's a priority. I wish this was not what we were dealing with. When I came in 3 years ago, I would have liked to. I had great ideas. There were things that, knowing the district, there were things I wanted to bring in, you know, things that would make us a better district and support our students in a better way. It has been nothing short of very difficult to just stabilize this district. So again, I do need your support. I need you out there supporting what's going on. My office is always open. I'm willing to talk to anybody and to truly let you know the state of where things stand. So please hang in there with us. As far as on a happy note, we do have a number of presentations tonight. I want to start with Stephen McGonigal, one of our wonderful teachers at Brockton High School. I'd like to invite him to come down and talk about a program that I had an opportunity to see in action, the Boxer Mentor Program, and again, going above and beyond certainly what happens in the classroom each and every day. And Mr. McGonigal, are you going to do a little bit of a PowerPoint for us?
Yes.
Excellent. Thank you.
Good evening to the school committee and to Superintendent Kathleen Smith. Thank you for inviting us tonight. I'm here with Jack Pyres, who's one of the mentors in our Boxer Mentor Program, and so we're here to just take a couple minutes and describe to you what the work is that we do. So the Boxer Mentor Program is a mentor program that I started 4 years ago. It's reflective of a big brother, big sister program. The high school students are paired up with an elementary school student from somewhere within Brockton, the Arnone School we've partnered with for the past 4 years. And they're paired together for about 1 or 2 years. Together we work on modeling positive behavior, emphasizing the importance of education, working on appropriate social skills, and also being a consistent and caring presence for the children. We meet as a group twice a month. One Tuesday a month, we go to the Arnone School, and we work with the children on academic skills, on reinforcing those. One Saturday a month, we meet at a local community partner agency within Brockton, and we work more on pro-social behavior and more recreational activities. We've gone to the Westgate Lanes, Fuller Craft Museum, the YMCA, DW Field, and a variety of others. It's once a month, that Saturday. Since I've started this program 4 years ago, I've seen so many benefits, not only for the mentees, but for the mentors as well. And something that I've seen is that many of those benefits overlap and are reflective of the other. Both the mentees and the mentors show an improvement in communication skills. They're both engaging in volunteering. I see an improvement in self-esteem and in confidence and in communication skills as well. I have some statistics up here that I also found interesting from the American Psychological Association, just associated with children benefits of being in a mentor relationship. When I began the program in 2012, my goal was to keep it very small. I received 18 applicants from Brockton High School, and I was able to make 6 matches with Colleen Proudler, the principal of the Arnone. Since then, the word has spread. Students love this program, and they get a lot out of it. They feel very empowered through doing it. And my number of applicants has increased every year. For next year, I've had 75 students apply to be mentors. And next year, we're also partnering with the Raymond School. So I'm able to put 10 matches at the Arnone School and 10 matches at the Raymond School for a total of 20 high schoolers and 20 elementary school children. seeing these numbers, when I put together this chart, I was kind of speechless at just seeing how those numbers have increased, and especially that 75, seeing that there's so many high school students who have this desire to serve their community, to make a positive impact, is an amazing thing. I wish I could put the 75 right next to the 75, but obviously that can't happen. But it is an amazing thing to see how motivated our students are and how much they believe in serving their community. Just some quotes from some of the mentors and what they've said. I won't read them all for you, but the one that sticks out to me the most is the first one. One of our sophomore mentors said, "The Boxer Mentor Program has taught me that family doesn't have to be by blood, and not to let the size or age of the mentees fool you, because they have the biggest hearts I've ever encountered." Every year I see these high schoolers get matched up with these elementary school children, and I see the relationship really blossom, and it's a beautiful thing. And again, being from a high school teacher perspective, having that high school teacher perspective, I see how this benefits our high school students so much, and it's evident in these quotes as well. Moving forward, I love this program. I have so much passion for this program, and I put a lot of energy into this program, and I intend to continue along that track. I have some ideas on how I would like to grow the program. One way I would like to grow it is extending the mentor relationship into middle school to allow for consistency until the mentees reach high school. So we see these children when they're fourth graders and fifth graders, and then we don't see them again until they reach high school and want to be mentors. I would love to somehow follow them through their middle school careers and welcome them into the high school as a mentor, having been a mentee for 4 years instead of two. I would like to partner with more elementary schools in Brockton. Like I already mentioned, next year is our first year with the Raymond School, which we're very excited about. But in time, I would also like to slowly introduce more elementary schools into this program. I would like to begin to connect some of our junior and senior participants to professional or college mentors of their own. Some of the partners that we've reached out to for our Saturday events have already expressed an interest in helping our mentors with this. And so that's where that idea came from. And the mentors are also very open to that. So that's something for our future as well, hopefully. Lastly, I just have three pictures for you. One of our events was a painting class. We had a local artist come in to the Our Lady of Lourdes Church Hall and lead them through a painting. Most recently, we had a cooking class. It was like the show Chopped. It was a little cooking competition where the mentors were matched up with their mentees, and they had ingredients that they had to create some creative concoctions with those ingredients. And we also go to Westgate Lanes once a year as well. Thank you very much for listening.
Mr. McGonigal, thank you very much, certainly, for that presentation.
Of course.
I think the facts are very interesting, and I think all of us know that. When you spend time mentoring a mentee relationship, you know, it makes a difference for these kids. You know, something to look forward to, you know, students to look forward to. Our Brockton High students are fabulous, and I know give back hours upon hours of volunteering in the community.
Absolutely.
So we will look to support you to increase your outreach. We certainly have 4,200 students at Brockton High School.
Yes.
So hopefully we continue as we've done and continue to grow some of these programs that have been successful. But thank you for what you do.
Excellent. Thank you very much.
Any questions?
Does anyone have any questions or comments? Mr. DiAgostino.
Just a comment. While I was listening to the presentation, the one thing, and of course it's this time of year where Saturday we were distributing diplomas, and earlier tonight, you know, in an awards ceremony, and then seeing your presentation. And the thing that I kept thinking of is just what an impressive group of young people we have at Brockton High, but and really in Brockton in general. But, you know, the academic achievements that they're making and involved in extracurricular activities, and then to go and mentor these younger kids too. It really just struck me that, you know, how impressive the youth of our city are.
Absolutely, absolutely. And some of the seniors that are graduating that have been in this program for 4 years have done over 300 hours of mentoring, which is incredible as well. Yeah.
That is amazing. Yep.
They are amazing. Thank you.
Mr. Gormley.
Thanks for your presentation.
Of course, you're
welcome. What was the origin of this?
An idea.
Just through you?
Yeah, it was just an idea, and I was at the Arnone School as the long-term sub in the library prior to becoming a Spanish teacher at the high school, and I stayed in communication with Colleen Proudler, and from there the program began.
That's great. That's really nice to hear.
Thank you. Thank you.
Mr. Sullivan.
I'd just like to thank you. It's programs like that makes this city great. You just do a fabulous job and a great presentation. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Mr. McGonigal, you brought a friend with you.
I did. This is Jack. He's a freshman, and this was his first year in our program.
So Jack, would you like to tell us about your experience?
My experience through the Boxer Mentors, I feel it's important for a younger person in elementary to have someone to be able to look up to in the high school and, you know, guide them through life.
Well, we're very proud of the hours that you gave, and obviously you've got a long way to go at the high school.
Yes.
So we're thrilled to have you on board and look forward to hearing wonderful things.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Again, in talking about our wonderful high school, probably one of my favorite places to visit. I'm always invigorated. I can't tell you I was much for science. But I love going into the biotech lab. It's modern. The kids are motivated, excited, and part of that is because of their teacher, Mr. Dave Mangus. I'd like to invite him to come up. Jonathan Shapiro, are you coming with him? Our department head of science, so please come up and...
Do we need to move? Or
I'm not sure. I think they're doing that.
Mr. Shapiro, do we need to move?
PowerPoint?
Or?
Students are
going to
use the poster.
Okay, great. All right.
Okay. Can you see?
Yeah, I'm good.
Just throw my bag out of the way. Thanks, honey.
So I wanted to thank you for the opportunity
for us to tell you a little bit about the biotechnology pathway at Brockton High School. This is a new four-year pathway. Just last weekend, we graduated our first cohort of students through the program, and those six students took a chance on us as we built this program, and I was so proud to see them graduate and move on to other things as graduates of Brockton High. Today, what I'd like to do is to let these three students tell you a little bit about their experiences in the pathway and how the biotech program is different from the traditional pathways that we have at Brockton High School for students taking science.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Aisha, and this is David and Nick. We're currently sophomores at Brockton High School, and we're all enrolled in the Biotechnology 2 course. Biotechnology is science that involves chemistry, involves biology, and involves a little bit of creative thinking. A lot of what we do is hands-on material rather than out of a textbook. Most of what we do is current. We do a lot of research about things that affect what is going on in the world around us. We're always working on something. Just recently, we worked on a trial about a woman named Henrietta Lacks, who had her cells, her cell sequences sequenced and put out for the world to see. And we as a class had to decide whether we believed it was ethical or unethical for scientists to do this and then publish a paper about it. And it brought up a lot of current event issues, such as should we be sequencing genomes? Should we have edited organisms in our food? And we do a lot of hands-on about just anything that has to do with now and that can possibly affect us in the future. It revolves a lot around engineering life. We can explore the possibilities of what life can become rather than what it is as we see it. So really the only limits with biotechnology is your imagination, and we can explore deeper into that using this program.
So with our imagination and with the pathway being biotechnology and that using that as an alternative course, the three of us were really exposed to more of kind of like what's going on in current science and synthetic biology from the BioBuilder program. So the BioBuilder program is a program that's offered to high school students by Dr. Natalie Cladell of MIT, and it's partnered with MIT. So what it revolves around is trying to get the youth and like the younger generations to get interested in like current science and synthetic biology, to come up with their own ideas and innovations to design something that could be helpful and useful to society, and allowing really like a younger generation to think of things that maybe older generations wouldn't think of. So our project was biological decaffeination, and what we did was we worked very broadly and then got more specific as we went through, and we actually designed a plan to engineer a yeast cell to decaffeinate caffeinated beverages without harming the flavor or the taste that normal decaf like beverages have. And that system we designed is more environmentally friendly, it's cheaper to use, and hopefully it's like something that the society can benefit from. And that program and BioBuilder really helped us kind of like explore a lot of the synthetic biology field, because we got to present and explore places like Biogen and Lab Central, which are like two kind of important areas in like the hub that's growing in Cambridge around synthetic biology and science, along with like the cornerstone of MIT over there. And from that program and from the pathway, we've been exposed to more programs. So the three of us, not only being the founding members of our first BioBuilder participation, also participated in the BioTrex program. And that program is where we wrote a scientific paper and we were awarded for innovation and visual communication.
So basically what Nick explained is only just one of the great things that we've done through the program. Also, within the Biotech 2 rooms, this year we did a great project where students were able to sequence their DNA, and then with that, the students then compared those to past Neanderthals and primates from across the world, so whether it be in Europe or parts in Africa. And then so with this, students are able to see that technically where they're from. And then so I see that with this project, not only we did learn about further into science, so for example, where to find the DNA, excuse me, I have a stutter. But yeah, so beyond the science that we did and the things that we learned, we saw that through this project, a lot of students, basically in the end result, where they found out where they were technically from, so many students in a variety of, I guess you could say their race, so it was a big mix. And then so with that, I feel like just science as a whole and our program goes beyond it, because now with this, students have a new look to see pretty much that despite all the problems that we may face in the world, troubles and just, you know, oh, I don't like you for this or that because of your skin, we see that in actuality, we all are actually one big family. And so that was just, I thought, really, really cool to see. And yeah, so beyond that, we just expect to continue with this, us three, and there's much more within our classes. Love biotechnology. Yeah, thank you.
Listening to you
3 makes me want to go back to high school.
Sounds like fun.
I know. We're going to have to. We're going to have to bother Ms. Mulder and have a tour of the different and new and updated areas of the high school. You 3 are so well-spoken, all of you, and it's just amazing to see, your enthusiasm. And, you're doing something, you're involved with something that you really love. And, take that throughout the next step of your life, when you're an adult, you want to be doing something that you really enjoy as a profession. And obviously, the 3 of you have an affinity towards this area. So I think I'm going to need to introduce you to a patent attorneys, because you're going to come up, you guys are going to develop some really cool programs and cool inventions, and you're going to need legal protection. So we're going to have to make sure that you're all set, But congratulations. Is there anyone else from the committee that would like to ask a question or make a comment? Mr. Gormley.
Great job. You folks spoke so eloquently
and knowledgeable, showed great knowledge. I'd like to commend Mr. Shapiro and Mr. Mangus for running a great program. A few weeks ago, I was at a softball game with my daughter, and a few of her classmates, or teammates, excuse me, were accepted that day to the STEM program, and they were so excited. It was so great to see students that excited to be accepted into a program that's STEM. It's not like the band or something extracurricular. It's academic, and it's great to see. And I really hope that you guys continue to build this program, and we'll support it any way we can.
I think MIT would be lucky to have any one of you.
Thank you.
Yeah. Anyone else before the students leave? No? Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Very impressive.
Thank you for your time.
Ooh. And now we move on to our last presentation of the Raymond School. I'll invite Principal Carol McGrath. I'm not sure if she has some of her team members here. I see them out there. I want to mention to everybody that a year ago we made a decision taking a look at our K-8 school at the time, and some of it because of space, some of it a number of reasons as a district. We took a look at the Raymond School and actually put it from a K-8 to a K-5 school. There was some reconfiguration of of classes there. There were a number of pilot programs, a uniform policy. There were many things that happened, and I know Principal McGrath came to speak to us early in the year. We've had members of the DESE out here to look at our Raymond School. There are accolades for the growth in the students, the change in the environment, and we're very pleased with what this year has brought. And Principal McGrath is here tonight to talk to you a little bit about the successes and the challenges. We did ask her to come back and let us know how things were going. So are we going to be doing a PowerPoint?
Okay. Yes. I've invited Ms. Mary Beth O'Brien. She's here to my left. She is one of our assistant principals at the Raymond School.
Excellent.
We're fortunate to have Mary Beth, so I've asked her to join
us.
I did ask Mr. McKenna, our other full-time assistant principal. Thank you
very much.
All set? Thanks. No, it's not going. No. Mr. McKenna is the parent of 3 kids under the age of 10, so this was a little too late for him to join us, but Ms. O'Brien is here, and hopefully we're going to get our presentation up and running. I know it's a late night for everyone, so we thank you for your patience. And I wanted to say thank you for Mr. McGonigal for he presented about the box and mentors. He come over to the Raymond a couple of months ago and met with Ms. O'Brien and myself, and we're very excited to add this new initiative to the Raymond School. And I told him I want all former Raymond students that are at the high school now to be our mentors. So hopefully a lot of our former Raymond students are part of that 75 that signed up. Are these your glasses?
Yes.
Okay, I think we're ready to start. As you can see, this is the Raymond School. This is I can't even think of it. So, Brockton Kids Count. We had the whole school out in the field, and we have our signs, and that was something that we did a couple of weeks ago that we're hoping to post on social media. So as Superintendent Smith said last year, the school committee voted on her recommendation to reconfigure the Raymond from a K to 8 school to a K to 5. And Tim Sullivan, Tom Minicello can attest I wasn't too happy about that. I was pretty sad. You know, we love our middle school kids to see them grow from kindergarten, go through middle school. You know, it was a great experience for us. But after the dust settled and, you know, I got over my sadness, got to keep a lot of the middle school teachers, chose to stay at the Raymond School. I have my eighth grade science teacher now teaching fifth grade science. I have a seventh grade math teacher teaching fourth grade math. So seven out of the 13 classrooms that we lost, those teachers got to stay at the Raymond. So that kind of took the edge off for me. So, but now that the dust has settled, I have to tell you, being reconfigured to a K to 5 has opened up so many opportunities for us at the Raymond School. You know, and we're going to share some of those with you tonight. And one of the opportunities is that we are now an extended learning time school. We were awarded that 3-year grant. And so now every Monday and Tuesday, the students stay until 4:10 or 4:15 in the afternoon, and they work on hands-on project-based activities. So as you can see to the left, we have first graders working on life cycles. So they've hatched eggs in their in one of the classrooms, and they've been journaling about this project. So a lot of writing and a lot of observations being recorded. So a lot of science hands-on lessons that we've been able to participate in and offer to our students. The middle picture, we have a fourth grade teacher doing fitness for life. So they're down in the gym, they're using the gymnasium to participate in activities, fitness activities. We were fortunate enough to get Fitbits, and the children can actually keep track of their movements throughout the building and in our enrichment activities. And then to the right, that other picture over there, to the right is second grade, and they're working on research projects. So the boys and girls they love staying Mondays and Tuesdays. They're there, like I said, till 4:15. The majority of our teachers, classroom teachers, stay as well. So it's great for continuity, and it's just a great extension to the day. We have some more photos. There you see fifth graders working on a science fair projects. They're conducting research in the classroom. The middle picture, first grade did an ocean mural. So that's going up to the hallway in our first grade pod. And then to the right is a second grade classroom. They're working on a research project as well. So having the extended learning time has given us the opportunity to have our students work on project-based activities. Sometimes, you know, we don't have all the time during the day. So this extra time allows the teachers to extend their daily lessons, extend the skills they're working on during the day into the afternoon. So next, another great initiative that we have at the Raymond School this year that was partly funded by the Extended Learning Time Grant is the Imagine Learning Computer Program. And I'm going to ask Ms. O'Brien to share a little bit about the benefits of this program.
Good evening. One of the initiatives at the Raymond School has been to improve reading instruction and reading performance among our students from K to 5. As a blended learning component, we have implemented Imagine Learning, which also came with some professional development for teachers. Students are given an opportunity built into their day to get onto Imagine Learning for a minimum of 20 to 30 minutes, and this also extends to work at home. It's an adaptive reading program, so students go through this program. There are some different activities that help them with phonics, word recognition, fluency, reading comprehension. It places them in the program, and then it follows along with the student's independent reading ability and provides them with specific instruction. So we've seen some improved benefits from that. It's highly engaging, and the students are actually very excited when they have their Imagine Learning time, and they'll talk about what they learn from that program. And then this then connects to another program that we've implemented in K-2, working closely with the reading department, the ELS, and our teacher teams. Our teachers have worked with a new reading program called REACH, which is funded partially through the grant and partially through the Office of Teaching and Learning. And what we do with this is it's provides a great deal of nonfiction reading instruction, even in the early grades of K-2, which has helped to improve our science understandings. Coupled with the Imagine Learning, we've seen some growth in students' excitement around learning when it comes to reading nonfiction and their readability levels. And teachers have had an opportunity to work in collaborative teams to build lessons and then execute them in a way that bridges science and ELA together.
Okay. Another positive effect of going from, you know, 1,025 students last year down to 775 that we currently have, or is like a sheer 780. We have 5 new students arrived today at the Raymond School. But our social emotional climate of the building has really has changed dramatically. Our office referrals last year at this time, just K-5 now, K-5, 480 office referrals. And at this time this year, we're up to 200. So that is a dramatic decline, and we are just thrilled. And some of the things that we attribute to this, you know, this happening is that Mr. McKenna, Ms. O'Brien, and I, we're available now. We've got more time to be proactive. Our school adjustment counselors, we're trying to be a lot more proactive. We're asking teachers to, before the kids get to that point where they're going to fill out an office referral form, we want them to contact us. We want to go down. We want to kind of, you know, put things, try to de-escalate before the problem gets out of hand. And another thing we did, which was, it's huge, it sounds so silly, but Mr. McKenna moved his office away from the main office, and he is now down in our guidance hallway. And I'm telling you, removing the kids from the limelight of being in the office, like, they kind of liked having that attention, being right in the main office. So that, I think, has had a positive impact. And then we also, this year, implemented Playworks, which is a structured recess program, and that has dramatically decreased the amount of office referrals we're getting from after recess. The kids are, they're structured, they have activities, they've learned so many games, the teachers are strategically placed throughout the playground area, and that has definitely had a positive impact on our office referrals. And then Ms. O'Brien.
One of the initiatives at the Raymond School this year has to build collaborative teams, which we like to call, there's always a gimmick or an acronym in education, as I'm sure everybody tries to keep up with, but we call it our ICE teams, and it's called Instructional Collaboration for Excellence. And basically what this is we've identified through, you know, a process, a team facilitator, which essentially is a lead teacher who helps to work on vertical alignment of instruction and messaging with respect to all of our initiatives at the Raymond School. Within the ICE team, we do have a lead facilitator who meets frequently with the instructional leadership team to really streamline some of our instructional efforts at the school. In addition, a grade level facilitator has been identified within each grade level, and that person also meets with the ILT, and this team meets on a regular basis. We have really capitalized on our additional time by building structures for collaboration. And within that group, we meet, we talk about the school improvement plan that also was developed through the strategic improvement team that Ms. McGrath put together last year. I unfortunately wasn't there to be a part of some of that work, but in watching that evolve this year, it's really strengthened the ability for teachers to feel empowered and have a voice in some of the instructional planning decisions that have happened at the school. Each grade level facilitator has led their teams through analyzing the Raymond School Improvement Plan and our initiatives there, and we have established a baseline for how far we have come this year, which has helped to shape our conversations moving forward in our initiatives for next year and next steps planning.
And at this time, I just want to take a minute to thank Ms. O'Brien. I'm sharing her with the Huntington School because we have the extended learning time grant, the same as the Huntington. We're now sharing Ms. O'Brien, and all of this work has been previously done at the Huntington. So to have her at the Raymond helping me implement all these new initiatives has been so helpful. So thank you, Ms. O'Brien. Okay, so next, I always pronounce it wrong. It's UNIDOS, the UNIDOS program. As you know, we are now going to have a Portuguese immersion program at the Raymond School. We'll be starting that for kindergarten in the fall. Tonight, we actually had an orientation for all of the families or the students that were chosen by lottery. So we had a good turnout tonight. It was from 6 to 7 at the Raymond. They came, we talked about the school, we talked about the program, and then the parents had to sign a commitment letter. And I have to say, all but one that attended tonight signed up. So we're excited for that. We're looking forward to this new initiative. We invite all of you Thursday, June 16th. We're going to have a launching event, and we'll have community partners and the parents and the children. So everyone coming together to just kind of celebrate this new initiative. So that's Thursday, June 16th from 5:30 to 7:30 at the Raymond School. So we look forward to having you attend. And last, but certainly not least, another thing from the Huntington School that I was always so envious of, beside the extended learning time, was the school uniforms. So back in January, Ms. O'Brien created this survey. We sent it home with the report cards in February. We got a huge response back from the parents. We had close to 400 parents respond, and that's pretty impressive. And I just wanted to share with you, so this year we piloted the school uniforms, and based on the survey results and based on a vote that the School Improvement Council took, we would like to have it as school policy for the Raymond School to have school uniforms next year. And as you can see from some of the results, or maybe you can't see, they're kind of small, but close to 89% of the parents are in favor of school uniforms. So we talked about that tonight with our new Portuguese immersion program, and the parents are all shaking their head yes. Like, it's something that the parents are really in favor of. So hopefully, with your blessing, the school uniforms will be a policy for next school year. This is a grade 3 class, and all we're asking is that they wear a red polo top, you know, college shirt, 3 buttons, and khaki bottoms. So that would be the Raymond school uniform for next year. So thank you. Any questions? Any?
Comment.
Sure.
During that reconfiguration,
yes.
I don't think that school would have made it if it wasn't you as principal. You and Mary Beth are fabulous at the jobs you do.
Oh, thank you, Mr. Sullivan.
I just want to say that I agree with the uniforms. It looks perfect up there.
Oh, good.
And I'm one that's 100% for it.
Oh, good.
Thank
Excellent.
You.
Yeah, we're really
nice
we're looking forward to it. Thank you. Thank you, sir. Okay.
First of all, thank you for coming tonight, and I appreciate the presentation.
You're welcome.
And I know what an important impact the ELT grant at the Huntington has had on that school, so I'm glad to see that it's being expanded to another school having the opportunity to benefit from that. So I just wanted to throw that out there. I'm happy to see that expanding.
Well, thank you. Yes, we're very excited. Like I said, I was envious for years of Miss Saba McGuire. We were colleagues. We taught together years and years ago. And then when she became the principal of the Huntington and brought all these great initiatives, I was like, the Raymond needs that. My kids need that too. So I'm just thrilled to have the ELT grant, to have the uniforms, and it's just going to make our kids just that much better.
Absolutely.
Thank you. Thank you.
So the school uniforms, are they just voluntary this year?
No, it was, well, this school year that we're presently in, yes, it was. We piloted it, and we had some students stick with it the whole year, but next year it will be school policy to wear the uniforms.
How much percentage would you say did it this year?
I would say 50%.
At the beginning, 75. It was great, but then it was down to about 50%.
Okay.
But still, that was a good showing, we thought. So we're looking forward to having this, the whole school.
You.
All right.
Very nice.
All right. Well, thank you, everyone. Okay, have a good night.
Quick question, Mrs. Sure. McGrath. You're so quick to leave.
Sure. Well, you know this is my favorite part of my job, public speaking.
When I was a kid in elementary school, we used to do in sort of reading these SRA or SRSs. I don't know what the heck they were.
Oh, yes, but they were SRAs.
SRA. Yes. All right. See, mm-hmm. Wow, I can't believe I'm remembering the term. But yeah. So,
what color were you on?
I know. What color? Were you gold? Were you bronze? I mean, it was color coded.
It was all right. Exactly. It was all you moved up with all these colors. And
you don't remember this.
I probably was middle at best, but whatever. So tell me about how imagined learning works. Like, what is it that does for students? You know, that program. So, you know, there's no SRA books anymore. It's all
computerized.
Right. So
what happens?
What does it do for kids?
Okay. So when we first implemented the program, the students take an assessment, and so they are tested, and the computer finds out what level they're at. Okay. Right, Ms. O'Brien.
Once students get to about the second grade, which I'm sure you've heard about, Ethan probably discussed the STAR assessment. The STAR assessment is a nationally normed test that also goes based on a student's reading performance or readability levels. And they use a scaled score measure, which aligns to Common Core. And Common Core uses what we call the Lexile conversion measure. Once a student gets to second grade and they're reading more fluently, they go into this Lexile leveling system versus that of a beginning reader, which are the early readers. And that allows teachers to get a general sense. And the Lexile assessment happens 3 times a year, similar to the way that we STAR assess. So it's aligned with a lot of the other measures we're using across the district. And what that allows us to do is identify a student's level in reading, which we use Fountas-Pinnell guided reading levels, which go from A to Z, if you will, and we're able to identify exactly a student's readability level, and then we can select books that are within their reading level, and then they, you know, can either read for pleasure, or the teacher uses that to determine how they're going to structure their lessons and differentiate so that they can meet the needs of a student based on their reading ability.
So basically, Mr. Minicello, the Lexile level correlates with the SRA colors.
Okay.
All right.
Well, see how we just it all came back.
We all circled back. Talking to us again.
Yes.
So now, what is the capacity in terms of how many students are able to utilize that tool? You know, in the
school? We were fortunate enough to have a site license, so every student in the building has access to Imagine Learning every day and at home. And I have to tell you, we have so many students using this program at home. And the progress that they've made has been phenomenal. We're very, very excited.
So it's definitely a tool that you feel is beneficial.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Okay, great.
Yes.
So excellent.
I also want to congratulate the Raymond School. We feel like it's been a very successful school year, a lot happening. Thank you for your hard work. I do want to caution you, Mrs. McGrath, that if you're comparing yourself to June Saba Maguire, Aldo Petronio is nervous right now. So we appreciate that comparison.
Right.
I also want to talk about the UNITAS program. And I want to remind everybody that this was our district capacity project. This goes mm-hmm. back to before my being superintendent. I believe it started in the fall of 2012. And what it is I want to, you know, we have 5 new members on the school committee, and it is labor, you know, management, and the school committee coming together with a project. This was your project. And you can see again that it took 4 years, a lot of planning, a lot of research, site visits, you know, to take a look at other programs and design our unique program. So we're very excited to begin this in September. I'm thrilled to hear that you have parents excited and are on board. We're hoping mm-hmm. to, again, add the French immersion program next year at this time. And we're looking at the time we talked about having an international, is what we called an international charter school, our own district school. And we'll continue to work toward this, so we're very excited for September.
All right, so. Great. All right, thank you, everyone. Have a good night.
Okay, thank you.
I want to move to the approval of our summer schedule of school committee meetings. We have come up with 2 dates very similar to previous summers. One is July 19th, that's a Tuesday evening. That'd be our one meeting during the month of July. And August would be, I believe, August 16th, and that would be our one meeting before school starts in September and back to a regular schedule.
Okay, so we would, is there any discussion on that from anyone? Okay, then a motion to approve. Okay, a second?
Second.
No further discussion or any further discussion? No? Okay, all in favor? Very good.
Okay, very good. Also, we met as a subcommittee, a policy subcommittee on May 31st. You had a presentation by our administrative intern, Gloria Chow, and also Executive Director, Dr. Sal Tarasi. We took a look at a number of policies from our coordinated program review. We had language that showed previous language in the policy, updated language. There were questions asked. You've had an opportunity to review those policies. We did talk about a timeline because with the coordinated program review, there was corrective action, and those were our first, I think it was 15 policies,
15
Dr. Tarasi? 15 out of 12. So, I'm asking you to approve that so we can move forward.
Yeah, I mean, we obviously reviewed those and were informed and discussed that these were Massachusetts general law updates that needed to be done. Really, it's quite frankly out of our discretion. I mean, we should comply and we should update our policies to comply with the general laws. So, if anyone disagrees, speak up now like a wedding.
Forever hold your peace.
Forever hold your peace, exactly. how about a motion to approve the updated policies as presented at the policy subcommittee meeting? Okay, second? Okay, any further discussion? Seeing none, all in favor? Okay, great.
Good.
Okay, wonderful.
I want to go on to the FY17 budget update. I want to thank school committee who were present last evening. I know some were watching at home. You can see that, you know, the school department, you know, with the city council, I think have developed excellent professional relationships. We have, again, we began this process back in January and February, had a number of meetings, including Saturday meetings, to deal with the many challenges. We're very pleased again that with a very difficult budget season, the mayor has met his foundation budget going forward. Last night we presented to the city council, and the mayor's recommended budget is $167.4 million going forward. Unfortunately, that was a $7.7 million shortfall that you have worked on for months trying to, you know, move the budget forward and able to move the district forward with very limited funding. In trying to even put forth our level services, which is not happening for next year. You know, we presently, just to reiterate, we have 93 reduction in force notices that have gone out. Out of those, there will be 34 that will be returning under the present budget. At this point, we've eliminated a total of 59 positions. There are 13 administrative positions, a number of retirements. Our job going forward will be to, and we're hoping to meet next Tuesday night and start to prioritize as the budgets are finalized in the House and the Senate, our state budget, as our city council finishes up their budget hearings and finalizes their budget. It gives us an opportunity to look at what we bring back if funds are recognized. And I have every hope that looking at the budget that the state will pass, that there will be additional funds for us to work with. So we're planning to do that on next Tuesday night. We also, under non-net school spending, have a requested budget, including additional buses and vans, some of them through our coordinated program review, needing some additional special education vans, a number of buses with the charter school that is coming to Brockton, and transportation we will need to provide to those students that qualify. The request is $8.99 million. The current appropriation is only $7.56 million. It's a shortfall of $1.43 million. Again, we do anticipate some additional funding coming in with McKinney-Vento, possible money that we're seeing in the House budget. So that should also be something that we prioritize as we look at our non-net school spending budget. There were a lot of questions. You certainly heard them along with myself last evening. They're asking us to tighten our belt. I think we've tightened it as tight as it can go. I'm not sure where else we tighten. To start to tighten anymore is dismantling, truly, the Brockton Public Schools. And we have to think very seriously about that. We're advocating. It is not one group against another. It is not one salary against another. That's not how we operate. You know, we will continue to so-called, as we go into negotiations, as we look at things that we need to, you know, in our district, curriculum, textbooks, materials, supplies, technology. I could go on and on. You know, we have certainly tightened that belt as far as, you know, going forward. So we've got a lot of hard work ahead of us this summer. We're looking to try to stabilize the district and continue to look for that funding that the school department so richly needs. And also, I think I want to end with, last night, one of the last things that we talk about were next steps, and I want to remind everybody here. We talked about bringing on somebody to work with Aldo Petronio with direct certification of our low-income students, a task force to work with the Parent Information Center, and to work with a number of those agencies that are certifying these families. So we will pay very close attention to that, where that is the new mechanism and the new formula for for certifying our low-income students. I'm pleased with the Senate talking to the governor about looking at the Foundation Review Committee's recommendations. And those are looking at increased fundings for English language learners, increased funding for our low-income students, increased funding for special education, and looking at an inflation factor that is tied to health insurance under the GIC plan. That's a factor that is out of control every single year, millions of dollars, when you look at the cost of health care. Chapter 70, you heard the discussion last night about the equity in education lawsuit, and we are looking to bring our attorney on board to talk to us about where we stand going forward on that. We're looking to continue to expand grant funding, and that sounds foolish when I sit here and tell you that one of those positions that we cut was the grant director, but as you heard me speak last night, I am very confident that as a system, we have numbers of people trained throughout many of our different offices that will collaborate and work together to make sure that we're applying for any grants that we possibly qualify for. And to continue to work on our Brockton Kids Count campaign to expand community support. If any of you were here earlier in the evening, we had a number of community members coming before us saying, what can we do? There's lots that we can do. So we will harness those people that want to come on board and truly make a difference. It isn't just about a budget. It's about a school district and what our expectations are for our children and families. And last but not least, and this does tie in, I guess, a little bit with the budget, is last night I talked about awards and accolades, and I went over a number of the wonderful things happening in the district. Mr. Gormley reminded me that I left out sports, and I love sports. So I want to commend tonight, sitting there with all of the awards given out, our Enterprise All-Scholastic Award winners, our boys and girls, our young men and women at Brockton High School and throughout the district, we're very, very proud of. And I will finish on another note. We did have graduation at Brockton High School on Saturday. We had the pick of the weekend, thank goodness. We had over 1,000 youngsters, and that included some of our alternative settings, along with our very large class from Brockton High School. It went off without a hitch. You know, thank you, Principal Wolder. Thank you, Deputy Superintendent Thomas, who I know work collaboratively to make sure that that goes off. Principal Wolder, I know you have a huge team together. It's a wonderful sight to see when you look at the usherettes and the ushers and the marching in and our students singing and our student speakers who were absolutely eloquent, you know, well prepared. It was just, again, I can't believe it's over in 2 hours. Parents have the opportunity to truly enjoy, you know, this wonderful occasion in the life of their children. And just to also mention, we also have, you know, a number of other things going on. You've got the prom, you've got senior nights, and all of that, you know, certainly doesn't happen without a team. Associate Principal Mr. Perkins, you've been at Brockton High for years as a student, and you continue. And again, I want to thank everybody for their wonderful support for all of those events for students that have gone on the past month. I think we're all exhausted, but we still have a couple of weeks to go, and we'll finish up. So again, that's been a great time in the Brockton Public Schools, and the events just keep on happening.
Do you want to say
like you do.
Oh, okay. I would just like to also add to what Superintendent Smith said with respect to the graduation. I thought it was a wonderful event. Mr. Thomas and Principal Wolder didn't report any matters that were distasteful with respect to our graduation. You know, seeing how excited the students were, it was great. I think that some of the new members, I would think you enjoyed the experience. From my perspective, it was an excellent graduation. You know, especially, you know, seeing some of our special needs students so excited and so involved, it really just makes you feel so good that they are included. We really do have a special school system where our students have, in my opinion, a high degree of sensitivity and compassion towards their fellow students, and especially those students that require extra TLC. And it was a wonderful, wonderful event. My compliments certainly to the Brockton High School staff. All the custodians did a phenomenal job setting up. The grounds looked wonderful. Everyone involved in the celebration did a great job. You know, our school police, our law enforcement was wonderful. The teachers up in the stands keeping order. There was a number of handicapped and elderly people who were shuttled and brought to the front of the stadium and sat along the sidelines, and that worked out very nicely. We have an elderly population here in Brockton that's getting older, and every year it seems like we have more and more requests for assistance with the handicapped spots and bringing people in and having them seated because they cannot tackle the bleachers. So I know Mr. Hatch did a great job in terms of taking care of the needs of those people. So all the people that contributed, my hat's off to you. There was one thing that bothered me in the Enterprise Online. There was a film of the East Bridgewater ceremony, and some of the texts of one of the students, in my opinion, unnecessarily slighted Brockton High School. It didn't sit well with me, and I know it didn't sit well with other people in the community. Just to let you know, on behalf of the school committee, I have drafted a note that I'm sending to the East Bridgewater School Committee just to express my disappointment. And that will go out, I think, tomorrow. Mrs. Alves, do you have a copy of that letter for me to sign?
I do. It's at your seat.
Oh, it's at my seat. Okay, wonderful. Absolutely not. I'm capable of getting it, please. If any one of the school committee members would like to just see what I wrote, it's apparently at my seat for signature. So, that being said, I think we have the best high school around, and certainly showed from the way, again, the ceremony was conducted, and certainly when you opened up the very well-appointed and nicely done program, I thought it was one of the better programs. I liked the cover of it. You know, you saw all the awards and some of the beautiful scholarships that many of our students. I think it was a very classy program. I really liked it.
150th.
Yeah, well, I guess we're going to have to step it up a notch for the other graduations. I mean, what the heck? Now we're spoiled and we're used to quality. So this is what we're going to have to get. So it was very well done. So my hat's off to everyone involved. Mrs. Wolder, thank you so much. You conducted yourself with poise, and especially with respect to the two students who unfortunately we lost during the year. That was a very nice touch, having their families on the stage. It was wonderful to see them receive the diplomas. So thank you for that. Okay. Okay, anyone else would like to add anything under new business or?
Unfinished business, we do have handbooks that are coming on the school committee meeting on the 21st. They'll have them ahead of time to review.
Oh, they got them, I don't know, 2 weeks ago. The handbooks, 2 weeks ago.
21st, so we will do that.
Okay. Anyone else?
Oh, subcommittee. Okay, so this summer we're looking to put together our facilities subcommittee to start to have discussions.
Yes.
We're not sure of the impact, as I said, of a charter school with our middle schools, but we need to start the discussion, as we said, at least get our group together and start to talk about, you know, things we need to look at for facilities system-wide going into next year. We have the finance on Tuesday. I've mentioned that already. So that is the 14th, is it? June 14th. And we'd like to have that a 6:30 time. Is that the time we've been doing subcommittee, 6:30?
That seems to have been working for everyone. Does anyone have a problem with 6:30, or do you want to try for 6? Is 6 too early for people, or?
But, it's a little too early.
Okay, then 6:30, that's fine.
6:30?
6:30, okay.
So it'll be finance, it'll be facilities, and you need to do your superintendent contract, your evaluation.
Okay.
So those are three that we'll have. Wanda will certainly poll everybody and find out when you're available.
Excellent.
See if we stick with the Tuesdays, or that might work for us. It's certainly a night we've been using for the past, how many months? 3 or 4 months.
Okay, and did you have the superintendent awards today, or?
We had the book awards.
The book awards.
Book awards were yesterday. As I said,
oh, yeah.
It's been a whirlwind. There's just been, book awards
so
were
you
great.
Want to tell the people what the book awards are? It's a very prestigious award.
So the book awards really honor, you know, students in your school that are your leaders, your educational leaders. And when we talked yesterday, you talk about students, again, you're talking about intelligence, determination, you know, motivation, and they certainly are the educational leaders going forward. They are our juniors. I believe we had 10 recipients from Smith College, from Dartmouth College, from Harvard, from BC,
Yale.
From
Yale.
Do we have Yale? Yale. We had Bentley, one of the Bs. I'm sorry, Brandeis, I believe it was. And I have to tell you, it was all women. So it's the year of the women. So the boys have to, I think, kick it up a notch.
It is a bit discriminatory, don't you think?
I'm just stating a fact.
Wow. Okay.
So we're, very proud. The parents are so proud. I have to tell you, there was one young lady that spoke, and she spoke about her parents. Not having the opportunities that she had had and how hard they work, and she joins them at some point during their workday and actually helps them, and talked again about how that was a small thing to ask, you know, knowing what the sacrifices that they were making. It's just amazing what these kids accomplish, and again, it makes you proud to be from the Brockton Public Schools.
Agreed. Okay, anyone else with anything? Okay. We all set? No need for executive session, so can I entertain a motion to adjourn? Second? Okay, all in favor? Thank you for attending. We're adjourned.